I am Dr. Sean McFate, and I am a professor of war. It's easy to study how the strong defeat the weak. It's almost assumed in armed conflict. But how does the weak defeat the strong? Were they lucky or smart? It's examples like these that more often reveal the true art of war and strategy. Welcome to the American Revolutionary War. This war is sometimes called the American War of Independence and was fought between 1775 and 1783. It began as a war between Great Britain and 13 of its colonies in North America. Again, this is not a history lesson, but a case study of strategic thought. Think of it as a sandbox to play with the concepts and ideas from the class. The war is a classic insurgency, yet one that succeeds, which is rare in history. Most rebellions, insurrections, armed movements, and revolts get crushed and relegated to the dustbin of history. The plucky Americans defied all odds and bested a superpower. We are going to examine how and why they succeeded. But before we do so, let's take a look at what historians call the First British Empire. The First British Empire is here in red. It lasted from around 1583 to 1783. And 1783 is significant because that's the year that the American Revolutionary War ended. Later on, well, as you can see from this map, England's possessions were all in North America. They only had a toehold in other continents like Africa and India. Today, when most people think of the British Empire, they think of the Second British Empire during the Victorian Age. And that took place mostly in India and East and South Africa. That's called the Second British Empire. And it was also lampooned or characterized as the empire where the sun never sets and the blood never dries. Also, England was not alone. It was not a unipolar system. There were other superpowers it was competing with. There were the older superpowers of France and, of Spain and Portugal. Portugal's not really a part of this fight, but Spain is. They got possessions all through the Americas and, more critically, in the Caribbean. The Caribbean was where the sugar trade was, and that was one of the most important commodities during this time frame, was sugar. And in some ways, Great Britain was also vying in the Caribbean, and sugar was, its colonies in the Caribbean were more vital to it economically than in North America. France is also a big rival. Now, if you look at this map, there you only see France in France, but that wasn't the case. 100 years before the American Revolutionary War, they have substantial possessions in North America, and they lost them in a war which we will talk about. And they, like Spain, have an eye on North America colonies. So England is in North America, but England's trying to push away rivals France and Spain from encroaching further into North America with North America's, you know, tobacco trade and other types of crops which were important. So think of Spain and France, like Persia during the Peloponnesian War, where they had fought and lost a war earlier, but they wanted back in. And they're waiting in the wings to see how the young American Revolution or revolt would play out. And if it looked successful, they might sweep in. And England is really thinking about that. And they're really worried about that. All right, so on to this war. Now, as you all know, like all wars, it didn't begin the day the first shot was fired. There was a historical lead up to it of events. And we're going to look at the road to war. And, you know, as one later president, the second president, John Adams, said in a letter in 1818, the American Revolution happened well before war commenced. It occurred in the minds and hearts of the people. Doesn't that sound familiar? Hearts and minds of the people. So the beginnings. Let's go back to the 1750s. The 1750s, remember the American Revolutionary War starts like 30 years after this, or 20 years after this, excuse me. The Seven Years' War was really the First World War. The First World War did not start in 1914. It started in 1754. And see this map of green? That is all French possessions. And the red, that's all British possessions. And then to the south, you have Spain. This war started as, you know, as French and Britain colonialists and power started to bump into each other increasingly in North America. And this led to a war. It started initially as the French colonists and their Native American allies against the British colonists and their Native American allies. And this was called the Indian Wars. But then it quickly spread around both France and English empires in 1754. And it lasted 7 years, hence, hey, the Seven Years' War. And it pitted really Britain and its global allies, which included Prussia, smaller parts of the German states, against France, Austria, Russia, Sweden, and Saxony. Later, even Portugal and Spain would join in. Portugal joined Great Britain and Spain on the side of France. By the end, this world war ended with France and her allies, including Spain, defeated and pushed almost entirely out of North America. And this was a big deal for France and Spain. And this is why France and Spain were so keenly interested on the American Revolution. Was this an opportunity for them to get a claw hold back into the, quote, New World, unquote? So in terms of North America, it meant, again, that, you know, France specifically leaves North America in the Treaty of Paris in 1763. And that also what's notable about this war, the Seven Years' War, is that in 1754, a young 22-year-old lieutenant colonel of Virginia militia named George Washington successfully defeats a party of French and Indian scouts in southwest Pennsylvania as Virginia attempted to lay claim to the territory for its own Virginia settlers. And, you know, after the war, like all wars, the war severely depleted the British treasury. And as a result, England started to tax its colonies around the world and its own people heavily tax them to relieve the debt. Britain imposed a series of direct taxes on the colonies, followed by other laws that were coercive and intended to demonstrate British authority to squeeze out every last pound or penny out of the colonialists. And this proved all, not surprisingly, extremely unpopular with the colonists. These new taxes led to outcries from colonial leaders who claimed no taxation without representation, because they didn't have a member in parliament to represent their interests. They felt that they were always just being squeezed and they had nothing to say about it. And this was pure despotism. And this slogan, no taxation without representation, is echoed today for anybody who sees a Washington, D.C. license plate, because citizens of Washington, D.C. don't have a member in Congress or the Senate either. So they're trying to make appropriate this cause. So Britain was broke and needed to pay off its war debt, and it raised taxes across the empire, and in North America, the, quote, king's justice was seen as an increasingly intolerable situation by many colonialists. Other grievances included the practice of quartering. So as more and more colonialists started to get more and more rambunctious and decry these taxes, Britain sent in troops to act as, you know, law enforcement, again, to squeeze out taxes, to impose the king's laws, etc. And they had this practice of quartering, which was despised. So imagine a squad leader comes up of British soldiers and says to your house, you know, you're going to house these four troops here, and you're going to feed them, and you're going to do everything they tell you, and yeah, and good luck with your teenage daughters. We're going to turn a blind eye. So quartering became despised, and in some ways, the British knew this, and this was a punitive measure as well as one of law enforcement for the king's justice. Also, immediately after the French, the Seven Years' War, the colonialists call it the French Indian Wars, King George III of England issued a royal proclamation that forbade American colonists from settling west of the Appalachian Mountains. King George made this promise to Native American Indians in exchange for their help during the Seven Years' War. Because again, most Indians of that war sided with France, not with England. But the colonialists also had claims on this land. They had bought legal claims. So in many ways, the crown had sold the same plot of land twice. And in other ways, the colonialists didn't really even care if the Indians there had claims to the land. The colonialists saw that as their land, sort of early white man's burden, perhaps. And so the proclamation line was immediately ignored by colonialists, and this caused problems between colonialists and Indians, and it caused problems for the crown, and the colonialists, rightly or wrongly, blame this crown for the situation of this. And this is called the proclamation line of 1763. So again, colonialists like bulldozed right through that sucker, and it's caused lots of problems, and everybody in North America blamed the crown for this. And it wasn't entirely crown's fault. It was not entirely the crown's fault, but the colonialists and the Indians, they weren't completely wrong either. Again, many colonialists had proper deeds. They had land that they had bought or land grants, and they were revoked without any appeal. Also, there were more and more taxes in the 1760s. For example, one of the most notorious ones was called the Stamp Act. This required a British seal or stamp on all sorts of paper, newspaper, commercial documents, legal documents. Basically, the crown or parliament was taxing every slip of paper. This was a huge money generator. It's like an ATM for the crown. And this is just one example. They found ways to tax almost everything. And these were cash machines. However, strong colonial opposition led, unusually, to the Act's repeal a year later, the Stamp Act's repeal a year later, because it was, you know, many both in the colonial government who worked for the crown thought, yes, this seems a little extreme, and they repealed it, which was remarkable. But this also helped encourage the revolutionary momentum against Parliament and the crown. Also, the Americans were influenced by ideas, and ideas matter in history, and they matter in war. So there was this idea that came out of the 17th century, the 1600s, called liberalism, and it really has some important roots in England itself. The idea of liberalism is this idea, liber is from Latin, means freedom. And this idea of liberalism really kind of means tolerance and individual liberties. And think of like the liberal arts in college. It's sort of like it's originally meant to be wide, becoming a generalist, having tolerance for other points of views. Well, political liberalism in the 1700s looks strongly at individual liberties. And it looked towards English philosophers like Thomas Hobbes in his book Leviathan and John Locke, specifically his second treatise on liberty, which talked about what we now call today the social contract, a term that did not come until the late 1700s with Jean-Jacques Rousseau, a Frenchman who's a little weird. But you know, nonetheless, the reason why this was important is because it changes legitimacy. In the old feudal medieval Europe, kings had the divine right of rule, the divine right of kings, that God put a king on the throne deliberately, and in some ways the king was the intermediary between God and his people, sort of like a pope in some ways, not quite a pope. But like a local a connection with God. And what this meant is that kings were above the law. They could do anything they want because basically God says it was okay. And if you were the subject of a king, which everybody kind of was, then kings were above the law. And this had led to horrible despotism and tyranny. And here come these English philosophers a century before the American Revolutionary War, and they have this idea of the social contract, which is no, kings are not divine. Rulers can only rule if they have the consent of the ruled. This is the social contract between ruler and ruled, and that the rulers in John Locke's case had an obligation, a duty to provide, for example, security and individual liberty and property. And if the rulers could not fulfill that duty, then there was a right to replace the rule. There was a right for rebellion. So under the divine right of kings, there was no right to rebellion. Under social contract theory, there was now a right for rebellion. And the reason this is especially important is because the British had fought their own very brutal civil war in the 1630s, 40s, and later. And this philosophy of John Locke and Tom Hobbes comes out of that experience. So the British colonialists were actually looking to the British Revolutionary War a century before them for ideas about the right to rebel. The right to rebel. And in fact, in the British or the English Civil War, it got so brutal that they actually decapitated the king. They decapitated Charles I of England. This regicide set shockwaves around Europe because it had never really been done before. And the colonialists in North America, 100 years later or so, said, if you could decapitate a king 100 some years ago, well, surely we can leave a king. We're not decapitating. We just want to leave. So all these became precedents based on a philosophy of liberalism and England's own experiences. Now, the crown's response to all this was not kind. They had a policy of repression, sort of a Clausewitzian response to revolt. I mean, let's not forget that Clausewitz died in 1731-32, helping lead an army to put down a Polish revolt and counterinsurgency in his day, which is this day, was, brute force. And so by the 1770s, the combination of high taxation, increasing brute force, led colonialists to get, rather than becoming subdued, it made many of them more angry. And it backfired on the British, and this actually fed the rebellion. And every time the British did something horrific, more and more neutrals sided with the insurgent cause. Think of Galula here, and that the Brits were playing whack-a-mole in some regard. So by, again, the 1770s, the situation had deteriorated to the point of a political revolution. They're not an armed one yet, a political one. There were increasing numbers of riots and protesters against British rule, mostly in the north. The most famous one is the Boston Massacre on the streets of Boston in 1770. It took place, and you can see here in the picture, that building behind, which was the colonial mansion and ruling where the governor ruled. And you can still go see it today in northern Boston, or parts of it. And the way, we don't know exactly what happened between the Redcoats, which are the soldiers, and this quote patriot mob. We suspect that the mob, it was, you know, classic insurgent tactics. We suspect that they started to throw snowballs at the soldiers. It's like a squad of troops. And then they started to pack rocks or stuff in those snowballs until, you know, they probably hit a Redcoat square in the nose. A shot was fired, followed by a volley of fire, and several colonialists were killed. And this led to a major propaganda campaign by propagandists like Sam Adams and Benjamin Franklin, who were notorious. I mean, Ben Franklin, you know, Putin has nothing over Ben Franklin. Let's be honest about it. He would make up all, not just lace stories with, you know, pro-America stuff, but he would make stuff up, what we call defamation and slander today. And he was pretty good at it, too. And this is a classic insurgent tactic. You bait the government into an overreaction, which you catch on camera, catch on CNN, you catch in the paper, and you exploit it, and you exaggerate it, and you create a David versus Goliath narrative to create sympathy for the insurgent camp. And this is something that Galula talks about a lot in his, you know, how do you defeat things like this early? And it comes right out of Galula, right? So the Boston, and then following this came another exaggerated event called the Boston Tea Party. And this took place in December of 1773, 3 years later. Demonstrators, some disguised as Native American Indians, destroyed in Boston an entire shipment of tea sent by the East India Company as a protest against the crown. And also, the British East India Company had tax exemptions from most of these taxes. And think about it. For those of you who don't know, the British East India Company was a joint stock venture company that was the handmaiden of colonialism for the crown. It later on, like, it settled England. I mean, sorry, it settled India. It had its own armies, its own navies. It was, and many at many points during this time, especially, wonder who commanded whom. Did the crown command the British East India Company, or did the British East India Company command the crown? And if you think about it, and we can think about it like multinational corporations today who pay like no taxes, the British East India Company, which is the major economic revenue source for the crown, was exempt from taxes when the crown was taxing everybody to pay back debt on the Seven Years' War. So the colonialists were keenly aware of this, and that's why they stormed this British East India Company ship, took its cash crop of tea, which was a cash crop, threw it into the Boston Harbor, and left. And it was a you know, and remember, war at the strategic level is politics, and it's armed politics. It's where political victories can translate into armed ones and vice versa. This is in the sort of, you might consider, shaping operations. It was violent. I mean, it wasn't like a battle, but it was, you know, storming of a ship and, you know, taking its crew captive and raiding it. And, you know, but the idea here, it became political. And propagandists, again, like Franklin and Adams, also, I guess, known for making beer, became the ones who made this into a political victory for the scrappy insurgents. Now, what was Britain's response? More coercion. So the British, after the Boston Tea Party and several other things, they responded with a policy of further repression, We're going to squeeze the colonists more until they subdue. And they passed a series of laws called the Coercive Acts. Now, later on in 19th century, American historians would later redub them the Intolerable Acts. Why? Nobody knows. Some highlights. They shut down the port of Boston, where the Tea Party occurred. And this was an economic, you know, boa constrictor around the neck of the North, which is really where the restive parts of the rebellion, that's where the core of the rebellion was. Of all the 13 colonies, it was really happening in the North. And Boston was its economic lifeline for both things like the, you know, British East India companies, for its fisheries, for everything. And by blockading Boston, they shut, the crown shut all this down. So they were going to starve the colonists into submission as well. The administration of justice allowed the royal governor to order that trials of accused royal officials take place in Great Britain or elsewhere and not in places like Boston. So this meant that if you had a British tax collector who was engaged in graft, and you had a governor who, you know, was raping people, or, you know, you couldn't hold them accountable in the colony that they served. You had to go, they were going to be tried in London. And people in London didn't really know much about the particulars of what was going on in, say, Massachusetts at the time. And also that the defense, you know, that, or the people who are raising the case against the crown's official, like the governor, had to send witnesses on their own dime across the Atlantic to do trial. So it made it very structurally hard to actually hold government officials accountable, because the government made it so difficult that people would just say, "Oh, screw it, I just don't want to deal with it. I can't sue or, you know, hold the government officials accountable." And George Washington called this a murder act, because it essentially was tantamount for green lighting abuse, corruption, and even murder by British officials, because it was so hard to hold them accountable. And this was done, you know, deliberately by the crown to help, again, punish the colonists. Also, the British sent lots of troops and ships starting to show up in Boston and other places to make their will known. Quartering went up, coercion went up. Between all these things together, this was meant to, as a punitive stratagem, to subdue the population into obedience. However, they did, and this is revealing, have some measure of conciliation. They did stop taxing the 13 colonies. And this was significant, because there were many in the Parliament of London who were actually friendly to the colonists' cause. And they felt, they also agreed that Great Britain had gone too far in pushing the colonists to this state. And so they actually stopped taxing the colonies, but only the colonies. And this created problems throughout the empire, because other colonies in, you know, in West Africa, in Northern South America, elsewhere, were like, WTF, why don't you stop taxing us too? We're sucking wind over here too. And it really shows that the squeaky wheel does get the grease. And of course, by doing this, they also they're doing coercive acts, but they're also rewarding sort of the quote bad behavior of the colonists. So, you know, it's a tricky line to draw if you're a British Parliament. And also, just so you know, in British Parliament, there's also a hardcore segment who thought the colonists were really irritating. One of them was called Lord North, and he really almost despised the colonists. And later on, during the war in the late 1780s, he becomes the prime minister, and is brutal against his, you know, in his vision as to how this war should go, with, you know, basically more coercive acts, less reconciliation. He was also one of the worst prime ministers of British history, which is a contest, you know. That's another discussion. But even British, it was to the point though where local English people in the countryside were being taxed more than the 13 colonists. So with this reconciliation or this conciliation of stop taxing the colonies had political repercussions around Britain's empire and even its own countryside. Many of those peasants, if you will, were like, why are these whiny 13 colonies now get a tax reprieve, but I don't, and I'm living in England, I'm English, they're colonists, et cetera, et cetera. All right, so again, Prime Minister Lord North thought that these policies did not go far enough. So there is this tug and pull within Parliament about how to deal with this rising insurrection. All right, so what was the impact? The colonial, these coercive acts actually backfired. As Galula tells us, it backfired. It drove more neutrals into the insurgents' camps. It legitimized the insurgents' cause. It made people hate the British more. And this is the paradox of counterinsurgency, one of the many that Galula talks about, is that the harder you squeeze, the more the states go between your fingers. I think that's also a Princess Leia line against Darth Vader in Star Wars, but the point is the same, that these colonial repressions, rather than subdue, actually encouraged the insurgent camp. And suddenly the states, there's also a saying in the military that mutual suffering creates bonding. And suddenly the colonial states, which had always seen themselves as unique, they were not like we think of them today. They're all one single territory in unity with I-95 linking them all together. No, far from it. They were about as similar as, say, Brazil and Colombia in South America. They were very different. You know, Massachusetts had very little in common with North Carolina. They would probably have more in common with London than they did with each other. Many people did not go to other states. You were a Virginian, you were a Massachusetts or Connecticut. You were not seen as this new United States of America. So you have people like Benjamin Franklin saying, we have to unite or die. We have to unite or die if we're going to hope to stand up to the crown. And this became a big problem. But in some ways, the coercive acts of Great Britain served to help begin to unite the colonies in their mutual suffering. And so the colonial response, and this is not unanimous, this is like an active minority, again, as Galula, T.E. Lawrence, and Mao discuss, is that when you think of insurgencies, you can't think about them, the entire population, maybe like 10 to 20% is all you need to launch it. The colonial response, and we're talking about that 10 to 20%, was to reject royal authority entirely. And then, like Mao, they started to form shadow governments. They started to form a counterstate. So that in like Connecticut, rather than having you have the British colonial governor, but then you'd have a shadow like parliament of colonialists who said we are not recognizing the legitimate authority of the crown, and so you started seeing these provincial governments with militias all over the 13 colonies, and they finally got together in 1775 and sort of formed like a Congress of Congresses. So you had each colony had a shadow Congress, and then that shadow we had representatives, and then each one of those colonies sent like two delegates to an overall Congress of all 13 colonies, and they called this the First Continental Congress. And so this sort of, for the first time really ever, did you have all 13 colonists like working together. I mean, before this, they were not working together. And this, of course, was a first draft. It was kind of, you know, messy. We know how all these things work. But this was also the roots of political revolution and organization that later forged what would become the first American or United States of American government. And they hope that this would replace the ruling apparatus in a Maoist-like logic. Now, the British responded by sending combat troops to dissolve these local governments and by imposing direct rule by royal officials. So they went even a step further, and now essentially they had a military dictatorship on the ground to rule, to put down this rebellion and bring order to out of chaos. So it was like basically a military dictatorship. And what they did is they also, the colonies mobilized militia, and fighting, of course, inevitably broke out between the professional redcoats or the British Army versus militia. Notably, the first shots were fired of the war in Lexington and Concord, Massachusetts, in April of 1775. And what was going on? Well, the British at this point, they knew these militia were forming, and they didn't want to face an armed insurrection. An armed insurgency. So what they were doing is they're going around to all the British armories in the countryside and taking all the arms and ammunition and shipping it into like strongholds in Boston where the colonialists couldn't get to it. So the colonialists wanted to raid the British armories to arm themselves, and the British army is trying to stop that. And that's the circumstance of how Lexington and Concord happened. These militia, they grabbed their hunting rifles, they fought back and scared off, if you will, the British redcoats. But this marks the official war, because suddenly you have organized, we talk about war being political, you have organized armed dissent firing on the legal armed forces of Great Britain. And Great Britain says, okay, you've crossed the line. You are now fully traitorous, you're murderous, et cetera, et cetera. So this begins the start. So the first Continental Congress gets together, and they form an appeal to King George III, who is actually marginally sympathetic. At this point, they knew that Parliament and Lord North and the Parliament was really hard over against the colonies. King George III actually had expressed some sympathy towards the colonies, and that's what they wanted to do. It's like, let's write a letter to King George to appeal to his sympathy, to maybe rein in Parliament, to maybe rein in these hardcore local crown governors, etc. And so they wanted him to intervene. They wanted George III to intervene on behalf of the colonies. Instead, it backfired. The king said they were in rebellion, and that's what sort of launched the war. So spring of that year, the armed revolution started, as I said, with the Battle of Lexington, and they also captured Ticonderoga and Crown Point and the Battle of Bunker Hill, Massachusetts. These skirmishes marked the beginning of the war. The War of Independence, and the first Continental Congress got together, and they declared their independence officially to England, and they wrote this Declaration of Independence, mailed on July 4th, 1776. They wanted to mail it by July 1st, but you know how drafts go. You have to, change this to that. It's before the era of Microsoft Word. Now, when was the last time anybody read the Declaration of Independence closely? Like, say, since sixth grade. You should. You should read it closely again, because it's an insurgent document. It's a model insurgent document written by a lot of people. Thomas Jefferson was the pen holder for most of it. He was a young, ambitious guy. He took a lot of credit for it later on, but Jefferson was the kind of guy who took credit for a lot of things and was always thought he was the smartest boy in the room and was probably fairly irritating. That said, he was a founding father of renown. So let's look at this Declaration of Independence to war. Now, Again, a few weeks after the battles of Lexington and Concord, now a new Second Continental Congress forms in Philadelphia in Pennsylvania. It succeeded the First Continental Congress and remained the governing body of the Revolutionary War until the war's end, its shooting end in 1781. In this meeting of delegates from all 13 colonies, which they call the 13 colonies in America, and the American Revolutionary War, we think again of the colonies as always united, but they weren't. This is really important. They weren't. People thought of themselves as Virginian, Manian, etc. Many had never even visited other states or interstate commerce, and that was not routine. Many of them also thought of the colonies, they were all independent states. These are 13 cats trying to herd themselves. That's kind of what it was like. So they put together, they agreed on this one document, and that's significant. Basically it says, after trying peaceable solutions, we are going to go to war. And they adopt the Declaration of Independence. Now, the Declaration is important because it justifies the armed rebellion. They're looking for legitimacy here. And insurgency, legitimacy is pretty important. You're trying to weaponize legitimacy. And so, again, think of COIN, think of Galula, think of Mao, think of T.E. Lawrence. They're all using some ideology as the glue to legitimize things. How does it justify it? Well, look at this. We all know this, right? We hold these truths to be self-evident that all, this is the start of it. It lays out the red line. Everybody has unalienable rights, and they are these three rights: life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, in the first draft, it was life, liberty, and property. That should look very familiar to everybody because they are taken directly from John Locke's Second Treatise of Liberty. An Englishman who lived in this, you know, he was writing in the 1680s, living in the 1680s, and he says that, you know, social contract theory, that everybody has a right to life, liberty, and property, and that if a government cannot fulfill these rights, then the people, it's okay, people have legitimacy to replace the ruler. So this is a political doctrine for revolution. And those clever colonists are using England's own philosophers against it. So this is social contract theory. Again, whenever a government forms that does not uphold life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, which you should read as property, then it's okay to rebel. It's okay to revolt. So here they are justifying the revolution. And what you need to think about is this, is that ideology is important in warfare. And the ideology at work here is called liberalism. Ideology bestows legitimacy. And legitimacy enables power. And in this case, the power to do organized violence, war, murder, things that you would not do in peace that are allowed in war. A lot of people want a justification. They want justice. And this is the chain here, ideology to legitimacy to power to war. And this is why Galula says in his four rules of counterinsurgency, the first rule is try to deprive the insurgent of their ideology, right? That's the place to start. Remember, Clausewitz says the place to start is destroying the enemy's military. Galula says the place to start when you're fighting an insurgency is to destroy the enemy's ideology or to discredit it. How do you do that? In some cases, the best weapons don't fire bullets. The U.S. and destroyed. Well, they drove Al Qaeda and friends out of Raqqa and out of Mosul, but they did they destroy that movement? No, because the virulent ideology that feeds this type of extreme Islamicism that has not been destroyed. And, you know, how do you wage war in ideology? There are ways to do it. We'll look at some of these in this case study, but that's for a different time of how do you actually do that. So again, this is, you know, we're seeing John Locke at work here. We're seeing Galula at work here. So that's the first sort of, you know, third of the declaration is the ideology and the cause and the call to justice. Justice is important here. The last two thirds is the list of insurgent grievances. This is just a bulletized list of their grievances. We talk about how grievance fuels insurgency. And indeed, this is the case for the young American insurgency, and they list it. And here's the big John Hancock. And everybody who signed this, by the way, knew that they were signing their death warrant because they knew that they were going up against a superpower. The superpower would not stop hunting them down until they were hanging from a tree limb. And so that's brave. They're declaring war on a superpower. All right, let's go into the war itself. Now, here we're at the dawn of it at 1775. Let's look at the colonies. Now, I keep on saying that the colonies are not united. They're not like what we think of them as today, as 13 united colonies. They were not. They were, again, they were like herding cats. You think of the colonies in three parts. There's the North colonies in New England, New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Connecticut, Rhode Island. There are the middle colonies in New York, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, Delaware, and then there's southern colonies, Maryland, southern colony, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia. Georgia, of course, was a penal colony before England had Australia to send its prisoners. It sent its prisoners to Georgia, where they died of malaria in the swamps, I suppose. But also, once you look at this sort of thing, when you look at population density, the cities were mostly in the north. The population density was in the north. Not a surprise. That's also where the revolution started. So urban centers, dense populations, that's the conditions, not just for typhoid to spread, but also for ideas to spread. Good ideas or bad ideas. In some ways, we've seen both T.E. Lawrence and Galula and many counterinsurgency experts talk about how to treat ideology or political ideas as a public, like a public health analogy of a virus. And you're trying to separate the population from the virus. You're trying to separate the population from the insurgents and their crazy brained ideas. And no surprise here, the populations that were densest, that's where the ideas of rebellion were brewing. Again, think of it like typhoid or something else like that. Now, there are problems with the public health analogy, which I'm not going to go into, but a lot of coin experts use the public health analogy, and there's some reason for it. Now, look at the southern, where it's most sparse, the southern colonies. What do you think the motivation or the appetite for rebellion was there? They were actually pretty much against it. They were mostly an agrarian society. The North was agrarian, proto-industrial. In fact, the Industrial Revolution began in New England even before it began in England in the 1815, 1820s. The colonies in the South were actually pretty pro-crown. They traded their agricultural goods like tobacco and other things to England. They had a symbiotic relationship to the crown. They did not believe in all this, kerfuffle in the north. And they saw themselves as standing apart from the north. And in some ways, a legacy still stands today. There has always sort of been a divide between the north and the south, from the Revolutionary War to the Constitutional Convention, to the American Civil War, to, you know, red states and blue states today. You have New England, liberal New England, conservative, the South. And it's interesting to see that this divide, this cultural divide, starts early in American history. So the colonies in the South and even the middle colonies were largely pro-crown. They weren't neutral. They were actually pro-crown. Now let's look at British means. We're going to look at ends, ways, means, and assessments for both sides, right? So British means they were called, their nickname, the Redcoats. I'm sure you'll figure out why. This is their professional army. The British had qualitatively superior forces in almost all aspects, but were consistently under strength. And as we know from Lawrence and Galula, military occupation requires lots of troops on the ground to hold it, lots of boots on the ground. It's true today. It was true back then. So they had one of the world's best navies, perhaps rivaled only by Spain at this time. And the colonists had zero navy. And so they could, with this navy, they could do blockades. And they relied on its sea power rather than its land power to maintain its global supremacy through things like blockades, through securing trade routes to extract wealth from colonies, bring it back to the mothership, which was England. And this required a big navy. But the problem with the Navy, as you know, is it couldn't decisively defeat the rebels on land. You know, the Navy can hit the coast, but it can't hit land. But what they could do is do economic warfare through blockades, which are sea sieges, and it gave a lot of mobility for the army. Now, we don't think of sailing ships as being particularly fast, but they were like warp nine back then, because if you were in the British, well, first of all, remember that the colonies at this time was, especially in the South, was really, it was just woods. It was like jungle, right? And if you were going to march an army, whether it be in upstate New York or in the Appalachians, it was like marching it through the Amazon, practically. I mean, we're not talking triple canopy jungle, but it was hard going. And it took a long time, and there was disease, and you have to move cannons. So much better to ride in a sailing ship. And this allowed the Navy to move its army around far quicker than the colonists, because the colonists had no Navy. And it allowed the Brits to do operational reinforcement quickly. They could reinforce points of concern very quickly, and this was a huge advantage at the operational level. They also had an army. Now, they had the really high-quality troops, but as I said before, they didn't have enough of them. So remember, as T. Lawrence says, the algebraic factors. This is a ratio of how many troops do you have to how much land? And if you're spread too thin, you're vulnerable. And the algebraic factors were against the British. They were against the British. So it's easy to think about them as being qualitatively better, but they were, even though there were large numbers of them, there weren't enough of them. And as a result, they only had 36,000 troops worldwide. And so what King George III did, or Parliament did, which was very common back in that day of the 18th century, was to hire mercenaries. Now, the way that mercenaries worked, and they doubled the size of their army by adding what the colonists called 30,000 Hessians. These were German speakers from Hesse, but they came from all over the Holy Roman Empire, from Hesse and from Hanover and from all sorts of places. Hesse is one of the larger, duchies, if you will, in south of like Frankfurt today. Darmstadt was its capital, which got leveled during World War II, by the way, by bombers. But it was common then that you'd hire mercenaries to supplement or give surge capacity to your forces, terms we use today. And these were not individual mercenaries, like they put up a shingle and they say, you know, anybody with a rifle can show up. It's not how it worked back in the 18th century. The way it worked is that one king, think of a king like a CEO, goes to another king and says, hey, can I rent your army for a few years? And here's a lot of money. And that other king says, sure, you can rent my army. Here it is. And they say, okay, Hessians or Hanoverians, you're going to go and you're going to play in North America for a while. We have no political interest there, but it makes me rich. Now, do you think that those Hessians saw a single cent out of that? No, they did not. They were just deployed. It's like you being in the U.S. Army and suddenly you're going to be hired out to the United States, to like Saudi Arabia
for 3 years in its fight against Yemen. You don't get any extra pay, but suddenly the president gets, you know, $1 billion. And that's how it worked back then. The kings would pocket all the money and deploy the troops abroad. And that was how, so the mercenary trade was sort of like renting regiments out to your other state peers. And they acted like mercenaries, and that's how they were seen on the ground by the Germans. They knew that they were being mercenaries, the Redcoats and the colonialists. In fact, one of the grievances in the Declaration of Independence is the presence of mercenaries. But those, some of those mercenaries showed up, and they were actually very sympathetic with the colonialists, and they said, I have a lot more in common with these undertrodden colonialists than I do with King George. And they lacked the will to fight. Many defected to the colonialists, and many remained in the colonies rather than going home to Germany. Then it was called the Holy Roman Empire. Not all mercenaries. Some of the mercenaries were pretty brutal too. I don't want to sugarcoat that. But they were mercenaries. And again, the last sort of set of means are the loyalists. There were at least 10,000 loyalists, mostly, again, in the South, who are not neutral. They were pro-crown, and they provide logistics and intel. In fact, after this war, England has troop ships show up in places like Wilmington and Savannah in the South to take colonists who didn't want to live in this new United States of America because they thought it would go to hell in a handbasket rather rapidly. And they had some reason to think that. And they and Great Britain sort of, you know, just like we do today, I guess the United States does with Iraqis and some Afghanis, it settles them elsewhere, like in the United States. In this case, they settled them. A lot of them went to the Caribbean and to other places in Latin America. So there were a lot of colonialists in the beginning. But towards the end, we'll talk about that. That starts to shift. Let's look at the colonies now. What were their means? Well, at the outset of the war, the 13 colonies lacked a professional army or navy. Each colony provided its own defenses with local militia, sometimes called Minutemen. These forces were lightly armed, lightly trained, and usually did not have uniforms. Their units served for only a few weeks or months at a time, and they were reluctant to go very far beyond their home. And thus, these were generally unavailable for extended operations and campaigning. Militia lacked the training and discipline of soldiers, and with more experience, and they didn't have the experience, but they were more numerous, though, than the British had soldiers. So they could, in some cases, overwhelm regular troops, such as the Battle of Concord, Bennington, and Saratoga, and the Siege of Boston. Now, both sides used partisan warfare, but the Americans were particularly effective at suppressing pro-British loyalists' activity when Britain regulars were not in the area. And they did that through some cruelty. Now, seeking to coordinate military efforts, the Continental Congress established, at least on paper, a regular Continental Army in June of 1775. And they appointed George Washington as commander-in-chief. And this is important because it shows again how war at the strategic level is armed politics. They had, there was actually a two-star British general called Horatio Gates who defected from the British Army to the young Americans. Imagine that. Imagine today, like in Iraq, the war in Iraq, a two-star U.S. Army general defects to, you know, Al-Qaeda or the Badr Brigades. That's what it was like back then. And everybody thought he would be the natural head of the Continental Army, such that it was, because he had the most experience. He was a professional two-star in the British Army. He knew how the Brits would fight. He had the goods, if you will. But instead, over some debate, they chose George Washington, who was substantially less qualified, at least his CV was. But the reason they chose him, they made Gates subordinate to Washington, which did not please Gates, is because Washington was native born to the colonies. He was born in Virginia, and that sent a political message to the colonies and to England alike that we are our own sovereign with our own heritage, and we have our own people. We're not derivative of you anymore. So this new military was led by George Washington, and in the beginning it had about 20,000 men who were poorly trained, poorly equipped, and about a third of them were militia, and two-thirds were regulars, but they were regulars name only. They were not a whole lot better than militia in terms of their training, discipline, etc. But by the end of the war, they had around like 90,000, but they always had serious logistical shortfalls. That was a major, major problem. Colonists also had a good spy network, think of Sun Tzu. They had locals on the ground. Washington and his subordinates managed them quite well. They knew where the British were most of the time, and they were able to stay one step ahead of the British for most of the time as well. And again, they had an active minority that supported them, albeit in the north. But that's enough. We look at, again, Mao, Galula, Lawrence. They tell you that you don't need to win over the entire population. Just an active minority at the beginning is enough to start with. And that's what they had. And they were also, remember we talked about Spain and France, who were still pissed at England, and they really wanted a way back in to North America. Well, everybody knew that, including the colonists, and they were trying their best, their damnedest, to lure Spain and France to support the cause. But Persia during the Peloponnesian War, they weren't, Spain and France were interested, but they were like, well, show me the good. Show me the proof. We want proof of concept. We want to see that you can stand up to the Brits, a superpower, and you're not just some scrappy little rebellion who's going to be relegated to the dustbin of history. Prove to us that you're worthy, and then we'll consider it. Now let's take a pause, and let's look at how the wrong art of war can result in failure at the tactical level especially, but really at all three levels of war. So do you remember Horatio Gates? He was that two-star general from the Brits who defected to the rebel side. And, without doubt, he had the most impressive war resume of any military man in the young colonial army. But they gave the job instead, for political reasons, to Washington. Well, here's why the United States today is lucky that happened, is that Gates spent so long in the British military that he was incapable of seeing warfare in any other way than how the British fought. And he was trying to fight the British using the means and ways that the British use. However, he didn't have that, because rather than having redcoats, he had scrappy, undisciplined army that's untrained, and he wants to fight them as if they were professional Brits, and they're not. So the Battle of Camden in South Carolina occurred later on in the war, but it's a great example, because here General Gates, Horatio Gates, is in command of the young American forces. They have numbers on their side, but they don't have the quality of the Redcoats, led by Cornwallis, who was a fairly apt general at the time. So let's see how this goes. He's going to go muzzle to muzzle with the Redcoats, because that's what he would do if he was still in command of Redcoats. So Gates versus Cornwallis, a Hollywood depiction.
That Gates is a damn fool. He spent too many years in the British Army, going muzzle to muzzle with redcoats in open field. It's madness.
Oh! Make ready!
Rustics are so inept. Nearly takes the honor out of victory. Nearly.
Gates shows us know your enemy and know yourself. You also see from that scene all the smoke created by the black gunpowder guns that was called, you know, the fog of war, a term that Clausewitz then uses as a metaphor for the, you know, general lack of intelligence and frustration of not knowing what's going on, the fog of war. So at the beginning, the colonialist strategic assessment beyond Gates was fairly spot on. They knew that they were facing a superpower and all the problems therein. They knew they were dealing with a well-disciplined, skilled army. And that they could, and that Washington knew that, unlike Gates, that he could never meet British armies of approximately equal size on equal terms on the battlefield. British, you know, had complete land control, you know, not complete, but they had good land control. Their land forces were formidable. They had a regular army. They had professional. They were disciplined, trained, equipped, even in adverse situations. And Americans were not their equal at all in skill or discipline. They lacked, Americans lacked responsibility or loyal, or Washington's term is duty, to fight. The Brits also had sea supremacy. They had sea control. And this allowed rapid movement that was, you know, allowed rapid movement to concentrate forces around the colonies. They controlled the seas, they controlled the coastal waterways, and they controlled most rivers. And this is important because back in the 1770s, North America was dinosaur country. It was jungle practically. It was woods. There were no roads. There were no I-95. The way you got to the interior of the Carolinas or Virginia or New York was on rivers. So if the Brits had supremacy over those rivers, they controlled the highways. This allowed them to concentrate forces and reinforce where they needed to in a much quicker way than the colonialists, who had none of these things. The colonies had additional strategic constraints. So remember, at the strategic level of war, we're talking about politics is and military victories, how they're transferable, they're swappable, they're fungible. The colonies were, like Mao, creating a counter state. And they knew at the end of this war, if they were victorious, they had to have a state to rule. They can't afford to slash and burn fields because that's their livelihood. And they can't afford to treat the people poorly because those are the people that they hope to govern. However, they also knew that they had to be tough on the British. And this is always the insurgent's dilemma. If you're too harsh, you lose the population. If you're too light, you lose the war, right? They also knew that not all colonists were rebels, and they had to pull them to their sides. So the colonies, the rebels, they were very interested in post-conflict situation, something that Clausewitz and Jomini completely ignore, something that, you know, Howe and others would have ignored. The British, for their part, knew that they wanted the colonies to be productive economic colonies. So they had some constraint as well, but they didn't feel, correctly or incorrectly, they had to win hearts and minds. The British general thought, well, we are, of course, the legitimate authority. So again, the colonies had a restricted use of force. This was a big problem. If they were too harsh, they would lose the population. It's like that old medical joke, doctor, the operation was a success, but the patient is dead. Now, initially, the colonies had no strategies. They sort of, and how many insurrections have started this way? A lot of loudmouth guys get together, talk tough, and suddenly, you know, the redcoats show up with, you know, tens of thousands of soldiers, and then these tough talking guys, like, oh, not our problem. We don't know how to do this. We don't really have a plan for this. And they had some very early failures in the war. So the first was the siege of Boston in 1775 before the war began. And, you know, at that point, this was still not all Americans, if we're going to use that term, understood this would be a full-fledged war. They you had some rambunctious Bostonians, you know, talking trash, if you will. And then suddenly here comes the weight of the crown. And this was a failure. The second was a two-pronged march into Canada by Philip Schuyler and Benedict Arnold. Now, you're asking, what? What are they doing? Well, before the war begins, the young rebels send up a delegation into Canada saying, hey, join us in a rebellion against the crown. You're suffering like we're suffering. Let's do this together. And Canada said, no, thank you. We're loyal colonists. In fact, if you don't leave, we will hang you for sedition. So perhaps for payback, at the beginning of the war, they sent two rebel columns through the wilderness of New Hampshire and Vermont, which back then was severe, all the way up to Canada, where they were soundly beaten. And it is it's something that we, the war did not get off to a good start, shall we say. So they had no strategy beyond harsh words. So let's talk about George Washington for a bit. So you saw Horatio Gates, and the problem of Horatio Gates, that he couldn't escape his own paradigm of warfare. He had no strategic IQ. He was just a trained automaton fighting, as he's always been trained, with no strategic or operational imagination. George Washington did. And the young American cause was lucky that they put him in charge, even though his resume was lighter than Gates. Now, before we get into hero worship of Washington, which we should not, let's also remember that, you know, Thomas Jefferson thought that Washington was a knuckle dragger, who was a mouth breather, that he was an imbecile with grit. And, but then again, Jefferson had something nasty to say about everybody. He even threw his very good friend and mentor, Madison, under the bus. And Jefferson is in generally a tired bore, if you ask me. That said, let's think about what kind of strategic thinker was Washington? Well, he was a thoroughly conventional one. He adhered to generally accepted principles of war of his time. Think Clausewitz and Jomini. He was a generation before them. They were writing about the type of warfare he and others were engaged in. Washington fought, however, he fought unconventionally, not because he wanted to, but because he had to. He was smart enough, unlike Gates, to realize that he could never win through sort of conventionally accepted ways and means. And so he was adaptable, and he became like Sun Tzu or Mao. Washington also distrusted civilians and arms. So all the glory about the Minutemen, Washington was like, he hated them, just like Clausewitz and Joe Manet did. They considered them peasants with pitchforks. Washington was saying, quote, if I recall, relying on a militia is like relying on a broken staff. But he did not have the foresight, and who could blame him in some ways, that Napoleon did after the French Revolutionary War, of mobilizing the masses in large. So Napoleon, 25 years later, had something called levy en masse, conscription en masse, using ideology to create large armies. In some ways, I would argue that wasn't really possible in the 1770s the way it was in, say, you know, 1805. But that would have been over the strategic IQ horizon for, I think, for most people of his day. So he was a thoroughly conventional soldier, but he had strategic imagination and could learn. And, you know, he was the right strategist for the time because he understood three important things. First, he understood the political nature of this war. Unlike Gates, Washington was actually a politician and a landowner in Virginia. He was part of their Virginia Congress and the national congresses. He knew that this war could not be won muzzle to muzzle, but could be won on the political aspect. So if war is armed politics at a strategic level, he, like Mao, like Galula, like T.E. Lawrence, knew that they were going to win on the political spectrum and not the armed spectrum. So he needed victories. This is key. He needed tactical victories to achieve that end, to sustain political support for the rebellion. An example of this was the attack on Trenton. It was a risky move that really achieved almost nothing tactically or operationally, but it was a strategic win that the rebels could, you know, propagandize and keep the war effort and the war momentum afloat. So for revolutionary morale, it was like an information op rather than a Clausewitzian Jominian op. He understood that the army was the embodiment of the revolution. So, you know, he understood that as long as there was a United States or a continental army running around the North American colonies, England could never claim victory. So remember this from earlier classes, that there are many ways to win. Victory is fungible. One way to win is just by staying alive. One way to win is by denying your enemy their victory condition. You don't have to annihilate the enemy. You just got to deny the enemy their victory condition. And if London's victory condition is the annihilation of the rebel of these rebels in the 13 colonies, as long as there is a Continental Army out there someplace in the woods, London can never claim victory. So, and Washington understood that. And that's a strategic analysis, not a tactical or operational one. So that's what he did with, keeping the army holed up in winter quarters in Valley Forge, basically evading confrontation, sort of like what Mao was doing on his long march. These were all examples of this strategy at work. And he understood that this cautious strategy ensured a protracted war. So like Mao, or rather Mao like him, knew the longer he protracted it, the harder it would be for London to sort of sweep this aside as a bunch of crazy colonials drinking too much swill. So if he could protract it, you know, it would be harder and increasingly harder for the Brits and better for the local population, because if the local population saw that these rebels were not going to go anywhere, then the neutrals may join the insurgency. Remember, the neutrals just want to be on the winning side. They don't really care for political causes as much. They just want to be in the winning side. So if Washington can demonstrate that the rebellion is not going to go anywhere, then that will attract, over time, increased a number of young Americans. And we'll see if that happens. Now, the colony's strategy, after the initial shock that there was going to be a war and the failed march into Canada, Washington was put in charge, and he knew, first of all, they almost bought it in the very first battle in Manhattan, in New York City. The Brits landed, they couldn't take Boston, so they wanted to seize one of the hubs of the rebellion, and also a commercial hub, so that was New York City, the next sort of big city down, and that became British headquarters throughout the entire war. It was New York City, an occupied city. And there's some horror stories there about prison ships and et cetera. But Washington tried to defend Brooklyn Heights. It was a complete onslaught. And the British could have ended the war right then and there, potentially. They chased Washington, but they didn't chase him far enough. They kind of chased him out of the area of Brooklyn. But Washington and his forces went all the way up to where today Washington Heights is what we call it. It's where Columbia University is. And that's where they sort of like regathered. It's one of those big what ifs in history. Like, if the Brits had just kept on chasing him and they captured him, could that have spelled the end of the American Revolutionary War right then and there? Possibly. It's a hypothetical, so we don't really know, obviously, but it's an interesting, one of those interesting hypotheticals. So Washington knew that they could never stand up to a full frontal fight with the Brits, so they would need a defensive strategy. So he knew that the nature of war, again, Clausewitz says, know the nature of war before you enter it, for them would be a protracted, defensive, and total war. They faced, and their ends were to eliminate the British from all 13 colonies, which was a big effing deal, obviously. Their ways, though, is something called the War of the Posts. The War of the Post, a post in this case is like a military fort, not a big one, but like a small one. And sometimes it's still called a post today. State Department people say they have a posting as well, which is interesting. One example is West Point. West Point, before it was a military academy in 1802, was actually a fortification, and we'll talk about it a little bit. But this strategy here, the War of Posts, is very Mao. In fact, this whole strategy is very Mao. First is that you'd have to have a strategic defensive posture based upon fortified posts and places of tactical and operational and strategic importance. The intent here is to resist British despite obvious deficiencies in numbers, equipment, training, etc. However, clearing after the British captured New York was not enough, right? So you had to maintain a strategic defensive posture. Second is to avoid general engagements. Again, this is Sun Tzu. Avoid confrontations with the Brits, who are bigger and better. So you're not going to engage in organized suicide. You're going to do guerrilla warfare a la Sun Tzu. There's a couple of examples where they had no choice but to stand and fight, like at the Battle of Brandywine. They had to do that because Philadelphia was at stake. The Brits were marching on Philadelphia to seize Philadelphia, which was then sort of the de facto capital of the rebellion. So the rebellion was no longer, Boston was under siege, New York was occupied, so all the Continental Congress moved to Philadelphia. And remember your Clausewitz. Clausewitz says one of the centers of gravity is the enemy's capital. And if you seize that, that's a decisive strategic blow in the war. And that's what General Howe, who was the commander in chief of that of this theater of war for the Brits, what he was trying to do. He sent out forces from New York down to Philadelphia to seize it and to hang everybody who signed that Declaration of Independence. So Washington had to sort of, that's an example, we had to sort of stand and fight against the Brits, and just as a sort of delaying tactic until the rebels could leave Philadelphia and go elsewhere. Third, as I said earlier, they had to defend the existence of the army. The army here, if you think again, war, you know, is armed politics. The importance of the army in this case was not that it was armed, but that it was political. It could not, you know, if you threw it against the Brits, it would be killed. And everybody knew that, including Washington. But he also knew that it was a political symbol of the rebellion. And as long as this army was out there free-ranging someplace, you were always denying Britain their victory condition. So one way to win is by not losing, and the way to not lose in this case is to never get your army captured or even into a fight. And then indeed, this army didn't really fight. It just went, you know, from place to place, evade. It's sort of like the Maoist, again, the Maoist Long March. So this was a symbol of independence, and as long as it was in existence, the Brits could never claim victory. Next, again, guerrilla warfare, raids and attacks against detachments and outposts, stealing their, you know, their caches, stealing their ammunition, food, etc. Good for morale, good intelligence. You know, this facilitated rapid movement to know where the enemy is, to know where the enemy could be, to know where your forces are. Totally Sun Tzu-ian, and Washington and his subordinates ran a very good spy ring. The idea of protracting the war, again, very Maoist, is that Britain would lose patience and abandon the war in time. Pure Mao. And this was the strategy. And also that not just Britain, but France and Spain would see that there could be an opportunity, and that neutral colonists who were neutral to both sides would start to see that this rebellion was a real thing and was not going to go away, and then might join the rebellion or at least support it politically. So those were the ways. The War of Posts, it's a Maoist strategy. The means are militia, again, which Washington disfavored, spies, the army, which was weak, but was a more of a political symbol of that had more political power than kinetic power, and allies. And they were, again, trying to attract Spain or France into this fight. So early on, they had their sights on the allies, but they didn't know if the allies would risk all to go into a war with another superpower, which was England. All right. So the British strategic assessment. So the British were, you know, they're thinking like Clausewitz and Jomini. And again, this is, you know, before Clausewitz and Jomini, I think maybe Clausewitz was in diapers at this point. I don't really know. But they're thinking that the best form of defense is offense. So this is very Clausewitzian. Their assessment was increasingly wrong. So one of the reasons that David can beat Goliath is that Goliath just keeps underestimating David. And so it's a self-inflicted wound, which is why Goliath was always saying, well, I didn't win, but I didn't lose either. They didn't shoot me. I shot myself, as if that's an alibi. But that's kind of the situation. So initially, they didn't even see this as a war. They just viewed this as criminality. And this is something you have to think about warfare. It's always changing. What do we privilege as war versus criminality? And look at today. Are narco conflicts in Mexico, are those wars, or are they just criminality? If you privilege it as war, then you meet it with the full force and might of a war mentality. If you view it as a police action, it's your means and ways are completely different. Well, the Brits viewed this as a police action, even though they had, you know, the army on the ground. The army was used in a, you know, as a law enforcement tool, and generally most militaries in history also do a lot of law enforcement. The U.S. modern military is kind of anomalous this way, that the U.S. military is forbidden from doing local law enforcement and doesn't want to do local law enforcement. But in the beginning, they just viewed this as a bunch of disloyal British subjects being led by some loud mouths and a small vocal minority, and if they just decapitate that head, the colonies will come back into line, and that they could also, because most of this rebellion was in the north, this is just a northern colonial rebellion. They're going to chase down the ringleaders. They're going to hang them. They're going to make examples. They'll reestablish law and order. You know, in a year or two, everything should be up and fine. It should not be a problem. And the reason they thought this is because there's no way these scrappy colonials can stand up to Great Britain. Now that they've earned our full attention, colonies, we are going to smite you if you really get out of line at this point. So the British, you know, but ultimately the British completely failed to know their enemy, the Americans. They believed, again, this is a conspiracy of the few. And they also knew that most of the colonies, especially in the South, were actually fairly loyal. Now, this was true in 1775, less so by 1778, as we will explore and why. And as we will see, this inaccurate strategic picture led in part to their defeat. Why? It gave, because a strategic surprise. They did not understand the conflict as the colonials did, that this was war and not criminality. It was war and not conspiracy. It was war across the 13 colonies. Even though it got its start in the north, it would spread. They also did not understand, or they underestimated, how this revolt could play into a geopolitical battle. They understood that France and Spain were waiting on the wings, but they didn't expect it that would actually happen. They didn't think that this was any more than just some thuggery over beer. So this created ends and ways mismatches. The more Clausewitzian the British fought, like, you know, think about Clausewitz, the worse it became for them. Think of Mao and T.E. Lawrence. British policy and loyalist actions provoked and created an ever-growing group of armed insurgents. So this is the classic whack-a-mole thing, that the more Clausewitzian or the more Germanian the Brits became, the worse it became for them, using a Maoist strategy. The Brits had other strategic constraints as well. They had global interests to protect. So this was a limited war, whereas for the colonialists, it was a total war. And this changes a couple of things, as you know. First of all, the will to fight is a lot bigger when you've got, it's a total war and you've got skin in the game. King George is not going to be hung if he loses. Everybody who signed that Declaration of Independence, that was a death warrant. It also meant that the colonials couldn't retreat anywhere, right? Whereas the Brits could leave. This was a war of choice for them. They could leave anytime they wanted to, and that was always an option on the table. And part of the Maoist strategy is to change and impact their strategic calculation, where they said, let's just leave. It's better for us. That's how the Maoist strategy wins. You convince the enemy to leave. You don't defeat the enemy and smite him in battle. Another big problem was the distance. The distance from London to the colonies. This the empire was largely centrally planned and organized and run out of London. Five time zones away in an era of sailing ships as the primary means of communication and transport. Also, they had a lack of troops. We always think of the Redcoat Army as being big. Well, it was big, but algebraic factors were always against them. Think of Lawrence, think of Galula. And so they never had enough. They ended up using mercenaries, which had other problems for them too, not in terms of loyalty, but in terms of quality. Some of those mercenaries, some of them were very good and fierce. Others were pretty lackadaisical. They didn't really have a will to fight for either side. They also had a restricted use of force because this, you know, remember in the first empire, their crown jewels of their empire were these 13 colonies for commerce. So they wanted to capture the colonies whole. And also, and this is critical, these were mostly transplanted. These colonists came from England. They viewed them as English. They were not like, say, Africans or Indians, which the Brits and other empires engaged in genocide. Because empire or the imperial age of this time really was racist. It believed in English civilization, English blood, and it viewed people in Virginia as their cousins rather than people in South Africa as heathen, as, you know, as whatever. And this changes the way they fight, as we'll discuss towards the very end. Also, they had time against them. They knew they had to put this down quickly. Remember Galula saying, you need to demonstrate a clear and decisive victory early to not just put the insurgent camp to tell all the neutrals out there that this is a lost cause, and if you join them, we'll kill you too. And also, they knew that if this thing drugged out, France and Spain, particularly France, might start sniffing around. And the last thing that England wanted was to face a near peer that was started by these rambunctious rebels. And so again, really, it was, you know, they had to keep the French out. They knew the French were a strategic game changer, and so did the colonials, and so did the French. The French were very interested, but they're not going to just back any you know, rebel force. They want to see one. They want a proof of concept first. And again, they needed to retain the colonies whole because they needed the commerce and the money. Don't forget, they still are running a huge deficit, and the crown is is out of money. So they need the economic power to the rent extraction from the colonies. Now let's look at their strategy. We're going to break it up because their strategy keeps on failing, and then they adapt. They learn, and then they do a strategic adaptation. So let's start with the very beginning. Their initial strategy from sort of the end of the Seven Years' War until the beginning of this war, the colonial Revolutionary War of Independence. They did not view it as war. They viewed it as criminality, as a conspiracy. They did not privilege it as war. And think about how that changes your strategic imagination for what can and should be done. What we privilege as war is critical for how we fight. We fight differently if it's just criminality versus war. So according to this, their ends were simply to restore order, which is what they were doing repeatedly in these interwar years between 1763 and 1776. They tried, their ways were coercive. You talked about the coercive laws to maintain rule of law. We talked about all this. But they knew that at the very beginning, they had to destroy the Continental Army, and they had to subdue the colonies by force. They're very Clausewitzian, which, and again, Clausewitzian was, you know, normal for his day. And that they were going to, you know, force colonial submission, to the crown and to parliament. Remember Lord North, I think is around this time is when he's prime minister, or shortly thereafter, he has no tolerance for these upstart colonials. And they were able to maybe offer some concessions, but they were not going to offer any independence. So their goal, you know, was to reestablish British colonial rule, And it was not to, and it was very Machiavellian in its strategic logic. Their means, again, are Clausewitzian, army and navy number one and number two. They viewed their loyalists as, they took them for granted, and they were mostly for intel support and for some logistics. It's not like they were having a large militia, loyalist militia, to counter the rebel militia. But this failed. This failed. Remember Mao, Lawrence and Galula. You can't fight their art of war, you know, using, you know, Clausewitz and Jomini strategy. You can't fight an insurgency this way if you're using a Maoan strategy. The worse, the more you work this way, the harder it is. What you need to do, as Galula says, is you have to fight a political war by eradicating this counter-state and rebuilding your political machinery, not by taking it, you know, not by doing it at the end of a muzzle. So to restore allegiance, the Brits thought that they, you know, crushing the rebellion rather than hijacking it, as T.E. Lawrence and Galula advise, that was the way to go, right? So instead of crushing it, the rebellion simply fed, this fed into the narrative of public grievance of the insurgents, which caused increasingly amounts of neutrals to join the rebel camp and more loyalists to join the neutral camp. And this helped swell the ranks of the rebels, especially in Boston and New York and Philadelphia. So the British, you know, army became a grievance in and of itself. So rather than restoring stability, it became a cause of more instability, ironically. And the more unstable things got, the more soldiers the Brits would send into that situation, and on the circle would go. It becomes a bigger and bigger grievance. So the British army, by its presence alone, helped swell the ranks of the rebels. Hence, firepower alone could not solve the armed politics of the war, something that Jomini and Clausewitz would probably be speechless on. Perhaps Clausewitz might talk about it as the power of the people, but he didn't think of the people as an armed insurgency. I think he thought of the people, like many people in his day and age, as an impassioned mob. As an impassioned mob. I think counterinsurgency theorists make too much of the Trinity without evidence for, you know, this insurgency from the Trinity from Book Six. But we can discuss that later. The Brits also had to protect the loyalists once they conquered an area, and this proved to be very difficult because they were already stretched thin. The algebraic factors were already against them. So every time they took and cleared land and they had to hold it, they had to leave a garrison there. That just compounded their algebraic problems. So holding places was difficult. And if they withdrew, the colonials would engage in reprisals against those loyalists. That might look like terrorism today. Do we see terrorists and insurgents do that today? Yes, we do. Did we see Americans do that? Yes, we did. Americans, it's funny how America and other countries, some of these countries are founded on precepts of terrorism that are conveniently forgotten. The requisition of supplies also by force. The British took supplies by force and it alienated the population. Howe denied the British the opportunity to live off of New Jersey farmers. So, you know, General Howe, again, he tried to forestall this, but hungry soldiers will do their thing. And the mercenaries ignored his orders entirely and lived off the land. Partly because they didn't have Howe didn't send them enough to eat, and also because they did what they want. They didn't really want to be in this fight on either side. And so the locals were the victims of all of this, and the locals, again, just like today, rarely made a distinction between the enemy soldiers and mercenaries. And this created a weakness in the counterinsurgency camp. And we saw this in Iraq. I mean, local Iraqis didn't really know or didn't really care about the difference between U.S. Marine Corps and Blackwater. They were all just Americans doing horrible things on the ground at the time. And in the South, and we'll talk about this a bit later, Britain's increasingly harsh actions and repressive policy push people away from supporting the crown into active opposition. We'll get to that later. But at the beginning, they made all the class, the Brits made all the classic, counterinsurgency mistakes, that the harder you crush the rebellion, the more you feed the rebellion. And so it's sort of like that line from Star Wars when Princess Leia tells Darth Vader, like, the tighter you squeeze star systems, the more will squeeze between your fingers. It's the same as the Revolutionary War. Not to say that there are lightsabers and stuff like that. That would have been very cool. But, okay, so the Brits, after the war began, they kind of learned. They knew suddenly they changed. To their credit, they changed. They knew this would be a limited war, and they did think of it as a war, and it would have to be offensive. They had to do it quickly. They had to snuff it before it spread to other colonies. And if it spread to other colonies, it would spread to Spain or France. And so they knew they had to get this under control immediately. Plus, remember, they still had a lot of tax things to pay. They needed an economic engine out of these colonies to fill their coffers that were still somewhat bankrupt from the Seven Years' War. And this was even compounding it worse. So they knew that they had, what did this look like? Destroy the Continental Army and Congress and force their obedience, right? So they had to destroy the rebel alliance and force compellence. Their ways were to isolate the rebels from the rest of the colonies and then to mop them up. The strategic logic here is divide and conquer. Sometimes this is called the Northern Strategy. So what they're going to do is they're going to cut off, remember, the rebellion's mostly in the north, they're going to cut off and isolate the north from the middle and the southern colonies. And we'll just explain to you how they're going to do it. They wanted to find and defeat the Continental Army in a decisive battle. And of course, Washington was avoiding this. So, the enemy gets a vote here, and the enemy's voted to not do that. And Washington was very careful not to make his army a target again after it almost got wiped out in the battle for New York. And the only reason they survived is because Howe failed to pursue. And if Howe had pursued Washington's forces again, maybe it could have been over right then and there. They were going to also occupy strategic places, just like, and this is not the War of Posts. This is more bigger stuff, like they're going to capture Philadelphia, which was the capital of the rebellion at that point. But they were also going to capture Albany and some other big urban centers and hold these places to deny rebels access to resources. So they want to hold these places to starve the rebels into submission and to frustrate them. But they found there were no vital places to hold. This wasn't Europe. This was, jungle at that point, and this is not European capitals. They were not trying to fight wars in France or, wars against, in Germany later, Holy Roman Empire. So that this conventional strategy of its day kind of fell flat because they found there were no places to really hold. And they wanted to cut the colonies in two. We will see this in the next slide. I'll put up a map. They were going to isolate New England, the center of the rebellion, from the colonies further south, south of the Hudson River. And they hoped that by dividing the rebellion, they could snuff it out and compartmentalize it and keep it from spreading. And once this was accomplished, they assumed submission of the other colonies as inevitable. Things would get back to normal. So they're going to seal off the virus, if you will. And this is, again, what Lawrence and Galula recommend. They talk about, and we see coin people today, they say they compare it to a public health problem where you think of a virulent ideology as a virus, and that what you have to do is you have to isolate the population from that virus. And that's what the Brits tried to do. And so they were going to capture again, and then they were going to capture and hold areas where there were loyalists. But there was a problem of ongoing belief in the reservoir of loyalist support, because they've discovered, as I just mentioned, the tighter they squeeze, the less loyalist there seemed to be. So this became a problem for them. So remember I said they're going to isolate the rebellion in the north? This was New England right here. The Hudson River, which is that river that goes from north to south, that was the sort of the superhighway of its time. It's for commerce, it's for communications, for political life. And they are going to, what they decided to do is and by the way, earlier I said I used Maine as a colony. It's not. It was part of Massachusetts, but it was all dinosaur country. There was nobody up there really. So what they were going to do is the idea was that British General Burgoyne would come down the Hudson from the north, while General Howe would come up the Hudson from the south, and they would seal off the rebel north colonies from the well-behaved ones in the south. Once done, they could easily bring the north to heel, and this would inspire the rest to follow. That was their strategic logic or assumption. But it didn't work out that way. Remember the mitigating factors of Clausewitz, one of which, of course, was chance, friction, fog of war. First, there was a major miscommunication in the British camp about the strategy. Burgoyne moved down south he came in from Canada and moved down south from Hudson. But Howe never moved north as planned. Instead, he went to take Philadelphia, the so-called capital of the rebellion, which is, again, a very Clausewitzian move. When he did this, this ended up achieving nothing, and his actions are difficult to understand. There's some controversy to this day about why there was such a miscommunication. There were issues of timing. It takes a long time for letters to go around. There was also personality issues. There were all sorts of issues, and revolutionary historians can get into the weeds on that. But what it did is that and you'll see here, do you see in this map, by the way, West Point, which is just north of Manhattan? That's a strategic narrow bend in the Hudson where the rebels, Washington's men, created a fortress, a battery on these heights that commanded it shot straight down the river. And they had a chain, this big, thick chain. Its links, which are still there, well, in a museum or hanging up, were about like, you know, four or five or six feet long. I forget, they weighed a couple hundred pounds. And the idea was like barbed wire with a machine gun for ships. A ship would sail up, it would hit the chain, it would be stalled, and as it was sitting there, the battery of cannon would blow it to hell, literally. And so it was a formidable point. Maybe West Point was also a deterrent to Howe, it's unknown. But here's what happened. As Howe and Clinton went down south into Philadelphia, Burgoyne came in from north. They went down south, but they found that this was not easy country to travel through. It is, when I was in ranger school, we call it, you know, wait a minute country, because your clothes always get caught on these prickly bushes full of thorns, and you have to stop and say, wait a minute, you know, I have to take off these thorns, I'm seized. It was terrible, and they were doing this in the summer in hot wool clothes, lugging cannon up and down these steep hills. It was miserable. It was miserable. And they got and Burgoyne's forces got mired in the hard terrain of upstate New York, as anybody who's been up there recently will tell you. It hasn't changed a whole lot. And this friction wore his force down to near impotence by the time they squared off against Americans at the Battle of Saratoga. The British surrendered at the Battle of Saratoga on October 17, 1777, to General Gates, and this caused a huge uproar, a huge upset, because this American victory was a huge political victory for young America. It was not just an enormous morale boost to the Americans and a shock to strategic British leadership, but this was the big prize. This was the proof of concept that France wanted. And so France said, okay, rebels, we're going to side with you. And we want to see Britain, our mutual enemy, defeated. Sort of the Cotillia, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. So France was convinced to come in to support the United States openly, by providing money, soldiers, advisors, and critically, naval support. It also widened the theater of war, because now suddenly Great Britain is at war with France. And even though France's colonies have been cut back a lot since the Seven Years' War, it still was a superpower with a global presence and an important navy. So this, you could argue, was the culminating point of victory for the Americans. Remember Clausewitz saying, you have to identify the culminating point of victory or defeat. The culminating point of victory, this is the day that the war is won for the Americans, but not the day that the war is over. No matter what England tries to do at this point, it's really diminishing returns, and it seems to be inevitable. It seems to be inevitable that the Americans and French will win. So this shocked Britain, and they reconvened, and they came up with Brit strategy number 3. This is at the end of the war. And they knew that the war now was really kind of a counterinsurgency war. And still, it's a limited war for them. It's a war of choice. It's not an existential war for them. So this is called the Southern Strategies. So Burgoyne's surrenders forced a strategic reassessment after Saratoga. And after the French enter the war, the British suddenly turned their attention to the Southern colonies. And why? Because they realized, this is going to be harder than we thought. And so they're going to go to their loyal base in the South of Loyalists. And their idea here is to marshal them, if you will, literally, and march them north and roll up into the north and just roll up the rebels. It also was important, too, because Spain didn't really enter the war with France against Britain. But Spain did also see Saratoga and other things and said, you know what? Britain's having a hard time, so we're gonna up our operations in the Caribbean. And remember earlier how I said the Caribbean was really the prize for the British. It wasn't the colonies, the sugar trade. That was the money-making trade. And Spain and Britain were locked in this fight for it. And now Spain was putting more pressure on the Caribbean, and of course, British forces and strategic attention were diverted away from the Caribbean to deal with this escalating problem in the 13 colonies. So what Britain wanted to do is they needed to move their operations south so they could be closer to the Caribbean, so they could run these dual theaters of war, the Caribbean and the colonies. And they had lost some vital ports to Spain in the Caribbean, and they needed ports that would be unassailable for their ships. So they looked at ports in Georgia and South and North Carolina to give them literally safe harbor. And again, their means were army, navy, loyalists, and mercenaries. The mercenaries weren't that great, as I said earlier, but they did help the algebraic factors. So What happens? So we're not going to go through the whole detail, but at this point, a couple things happen. British coerciveness by this point in the war, by 1778 and later, they're coercive all up and down, and it's starting to backfire. And many loyalists who at the beginning of the war would have joined the crown are now either neutral or actively have joined the rebellion. And this is a major strategic oversight for the Brits, who, again, are Clausewitzian and Jovinian. Clausewitz doesn't really care. I mean, he talked about the people in the Trinity, but he doesn't explain how to win them over the way that Mao and Galula do. He just mentions them, and that's not really an excuse for him being a populist military leader. The rebel militias successfully attacked loyalist outposts. So a couple things. So what, well, going back to the rebels, the British brutality was a major problem. We had something called Tarleton's Quarter. Tarleton was like, I think it was a lieutenant colonel who was a redcoat. He was a cavalry commander, and he was particularly harsh for his slaughtering of the innocents and burning down their farms. And they would slaughter rebels. And this just fueled the narrative of David versus Goliath that fed into the insurgency's strategic narrative. They also burned settlements like that of Thomas Sumter. They were also hostile to the Presbyterian Church, which, because remember, church politics were still a big deal, Catholic versus Protestant, to be sure, but Episcopalian versus Presbyterian versus others. And this really alienated Scotch-Irish loyalists. And they also ended up with a system, they ended a system of parole for rebels. And this, what this meant is that if you were seen as a rebel, you could be given like some sort of amnesty if you just like lay down your arms and you stop the cause. Well, this forced neutrals into making a hard choice between rebels and loyalty, and many chose to join the rebels unnecessarily. Maybe you could argue you needed to have more parole, give colonists more opportunity to, quote, do the right thing and support the crown. And lastly, that the British and loyalists did a lot of indiscriminate looting with, quote, legal seizures. They'd show up with some document saying, yeah, your farm is mine. And this really, you know, this had been going on since the beginning of the war. And by the time the Southern strategy starts, a lot of people in the South are like, I've had it with the crown. Those people in the North, even though they speak funny and they dress funny, they're onto something. And I'm actually joining the 13 colonies. I'm not joining the crown. Also, there was this guy called Nathanael Greene, who's amazing. There were two amazing guerrilla warfare leaders at this time. One was Greene, and he practiced what Mao would call mobile warfare. And the other was Francis Marion, who was out of South Carolina, and he was called the Swamp Fox. And they led brilliant guerrilla warfare, or to use Maoist terminology, mobile warfare against the Brits to frustrate them, to degrade them, to demoralize them, to confuse them, to weaponize the friction of what was then very dense, you know, swamp and, you know, we might jungle, stuff like that. So, and this was significant because it showed, this is how Mao says, this is how you win. Protract the warfare, fight guerrilla war, et cetera, et cetera. And they won some operational art victories that proved pretty important towards the end. Cowpens, King's Mountain, and eventually Yorktown. So Yorktown is where it all ends. So Cornwallis is, you know, remember Camden takes place down here. Cornwallis and his troops are beleaguered by having to travel through this dinosaur country in hot, humid weather. Nothing is going as planned. They think they've got Greene. He's over here, but he's really over there. Swamp Fox as well. And they're like, basta. We need to round up. We need to go back to New York, the headquarters, and come up with a new strategy because this one isn't working. So Greene and Marion, they succeeded in frustrating their enemy, not with superior firearms and kinetic power, but by doing, you know, weaponizing the environment. So Cornwallis goes up to Yorktown, which is this peninsula, and he's waiting for the British fleet to pick up his army and move him up to New York City. Remember how the fleet gives nobility. And lo and behold, this Washington is all over this. They realize that the French realize and Washington realizes that the entire British army is on this small peninsula. And amazingly, they rush every rebel unit and French unit they have down to Yorktown, where they capture they barricade in the British army on this tiny peninsula as the British army is waiting to be picked up by their fleet. But unknown to the British is that their fleet was already destroyed by the French fleet in the Chesapeake Bay. They didn't see it because it was sort of over the horizon. It was too far away, but nobody was coming to save them. No, Cornwallis, who is too proud to surrender to this rabble, they put up a fight, and the Battle of Yorktown was brutal because it sort of was like World War I with trench warfare. The Brits had made these two or three big dugouts, and the French and the Americans attacked at night, and it was just brutal hand-to-hand combat. But by like, I don't know, day three or something, the British surrendered. They surrendered. And here is the Battle of Yorktown, the surrender. The French and the Americans formed two lines from the encampment of the British to a disarmament site, I don't know, like a half a mile away. And they lined their troops. On the right, as you can see in blue, are the American soldiers. And on the left, in white, are the French soldiers. And the French flag is white. So I know you're going to crack some French jokes, but surrender. But that was actually the color of the French king. And it was a king at that point. And the humiliated British had to march down this twin column and surrender their arms. And this was a huge embarrassment. Normally it was customary for the British, the losers band to play the sort of the song of the winner. But the Americans didn't have a national anthem or anything like that. So it's alleged that the British band played a song from the Old English Civil War of The World Turned Upside Down, of which is a cover of it in the musical Hamilton. It's an allegation. We don't know. Nobody I know is there. So this happened in 1781. The shooting war was over. It would be another 2 years before they actually had a treaty, the Treaty of Paris, that sort of sealed the deal. But remember, you know, England had other more pressing problems elsewhere. So it is true that they could have stayed on for a fourth strategy, but they chose not to. They had global interests elsewhere, like the sugar trade in the Caribbean with the Spanish. There was a war for sugar. They also had big revolts in India, where Cornwallis, who was then the commander here, was sent. And you'd think Cornwallis's career would be over here, but actually it was just beginning. He became eventually the head of the British East India Company and one of the wealthiest men in Great Britain at the time, and he's buried in Calcutta to this day. So he went over there from here to India to put down the Mysore Rebellion against a very powerful local Indian prince. But he fought a very different war. His war over there was genocidal, and they were successful. And one asks, why genocidal in India and not genocidal in North America? Well, there might be two reasons. One is that North America was a hub of industry. It was an agricultural powerhouse, whereas these were not, they were subduing existing principalities in India rather than collecting, you know, they didn't have the whole like cotton system, whatever, tobacco system up and running. The second is many have argued that it's racist, that, you know, these were brown people, they were not white people, and they were okay to slaughter. And if you look at the ideology of empire from this time, there was certainly a lot of British blood, German blood. France is a little bit different after the French Revolution because they got away from this idea. But this idea of empire, like in the 19th century in England, was very racial. And lastly, it's also possible that Britain expected mayhem to follow Yorktown, and that the Americans would be begging back the crown for law and order in a few years to restore order. Why would they assume this? Because that's what happened to them during their bitter civil war a century earlier. And to this day, many successful revolutions devolve into war. During the French Revolution, there was a saying, "Revolutions devour their children." And we see this again today over and over and over again. The Americans didn't do that. And the question as to why. It was rough. The 1780s and the 1790s were very difficult. And Washington did squelch a lot of local rebels, like the Whiskey Rebellion and Nat Turner and others as well. So it wasn't all rainbows and unicorns. So America enjoyed strategic success, and let's look at maybe why that was the case. Was it lucky or was it smart? You decide. First of all, they had a successful insurgency, and they stuck to a Maoist strategy, which backfires on, you know, sort of, if you will, regular or conventional forces strategy, which is what the Brits employed at the time. The Brits were using Clausewitz, and the Americans were using Mao. And it kind of turned out Mao was right. They heavily used intelligence and guerrilla warfare. Again, this is pure Sun Tzu. Washington understood the enemy and understood himself and the limits of his own army. And he understood that he had to keep the Continental Army alive to deny the British their victory condition. This is sneakiness. It's Sun Tzu. It's not Clausewitz. It's not Jomini. Jomini and Clausewitz would view these such, well, they probably, I'm not sure they would get the Continental Army bit. They might, but, you know, if you wipe out the enemy's army, you're pretty much close to victorious. But this idea of being cunning and denying your enemy a victory condition would have been, as Sun Tzu would have understood it, would probably not be obvious to Howe. Also, Cotillia and to some extent, like T.E. Lawrence, the young Americans were able to attract allegiances in France from France and at least some sympathy for Spain. And Spain did not come in as fully as France, but Spain was able to make life hard. You know, Spain diluted the strategic attention span of Great Britain from the 13 colonies by the war for sugar. And lastly, and this is also important, is that they understood, the Americans understood, that they could not alienate the people because they hoped to govern them afterwards. This is Galula, this is Mao, and this is also Sun Tzu says, take the state intact. You could argue, and people have, that it's also Clausewitz. Clausewitz talks to Trinity about the people and how they matter for war. I personally think that those people are reading too much into Clausewitz and his Trinity, too much into Book 6, which talks about sort of peasants and warfare. However, the argument is made, and it's not it's a legit argument. And lastly, chance. There's lots of chance involved in this. So here and there, we can talk about that, the tactical level, at the strategic level as well. All right, so let's look at reasons for British failure. Those are sometimes more revealing. One is that they were reactionary in their strategic thought. Their adaptations were always, as they say, a day late, a dollar short. They did not really comprehend, always until it was too late, the gravity of their situation, particularly when it comes to what it would take to bring France into the war. Right, and that was the culminating point of defeat for the British. Second is that the Brits continued to underestimate the enemy and overestimate themselves. This is a Sun Tzu thing. They thought that these were just peasants with pitchforks and that they would be crushed under the weight of a professional army. That's Clausewitzian thinking. Whereas Sun Tzu shows that there's another way, and Mao builds on that to do a way that Washington seems to have employed. No, the Brits did not also understand the nature of war. The Americans were fighting a total war. The Brits were fighting a limited one. And this, of course, is one way that David can beat Goliath, but it's not just the only way. So you hear this today, like, well, America, we all know that America lost in Vietnam because the North Vietnamese were fighting a limited war and we were fighting a total war. Well, that's part of it. But the North Vietnamese were also using strategies like Maoist strategies that allow the weak to defeat the strong. So the Americans were fighting a total war and we're also using strategies that allows the weak to defeat the strong. And the British kept them playing into their hands because they didn't understand the nature of the war. There were many coin paradoxes. This is Galula. So like the British army by its presence alone was the major grievance. And this helped swell and feed the rebellion's ranks. And their British actions, to be coercive, to compel compliance, which is a very Clausewitzian idea, actually pushed neutrals into active oppositions that worked against them. The Brits, again, were spread too thin. Their algebraic factors were always against them. They couldn't protect all the loyalists. And if they couldn't protect the loyalists, some of those loyalists would become rebels. They couldn't hold territory. If they withdrew, then it sends the wrong political message to loyalists that they are not safe. And again, this further moves neutrals into the insurgent camp. The Brits, again, fought a Clausewitzian warfare against an insurgency, and this backfires if you use a Maoist or Galula strategy. They also have diplomatic failure. They could not keep France and Spain out. This is Cotillia. They were not thinking about sort of the grand strategic aspects. They thought of this as disloyal criminals into a haphazard army until, oh my God, how did France get involved in this? To, oh my God, how did our fleet get sunk? And our army get captured. And that's sort of how it happened. And they also had logistical and admin challenges. Again, London tried to run a centralized empire out of one city, London, five time zones away. And this created problems. Mercenaries acted badly. This created problems because the mercenaries were seen as part of the same as redcoats, right? They fought for the same flag. How were they different? And the lack of command and control between London and New York and between field commanders, between, say, Howe and Clinton in New York versus Burgoyne coming down the Hudson. I mean, how did that happen? And the other examples of that, too. They were hindered by the distance. Now, were there British alternatives? This is the dangerous game of counterfactuals, but it's kind of interesting to think about. So, one, they could have done the whole Clausewitzian and Jomenian thing and sought to destroy the Continental Army and take the capital. That's what, in strategy two, that's what Howe was trying to do. They was trying to take Philadelphia and find and fix and kill the Continental Army, but they couldn't quite do it. If they had tried again, if they could have been picked up from Yorktown, could they have done that? I don't know if they could have done that. I think it'd be kind of hard after several years. They could have tried a Galula approach, which would not have been on their strategic radar at all. But could they have rebuilt a political machine in the colonies in the north in 1770? So rather than being excessively coercive, were there ways to address the grievances and build a better deal and reestablish colonial rule, not through brute force, but by dealing with grievances, but through the power of ideas, through all these things? So could they have built a political apparatus? Could they have fostered a counter-revolution in the loyal South against the colonies as Lawrence? I mean, could they have sent in like a Lawrence into the South to whip them up into an actual army supported by the Redcoats to augment their army? And could they have done just economic isolation through blockades? They were doing that with New England, but could they have done that through all 13 colonies? And also, would that have hurt them as well? So I'll leave it with these brain teasers. Britain won almost every battle but lost the war. why? Were the Americans more lucky or smart? Could the Americans have won independence without France? What was more important, diplomacy or military instruments of power? How did bias, strategic bias, hinder British strategic thought and adaptation? Washington wanted to be a Clausewitzian but had to be a Maoist. Gates could not adapt and lost. What is the relationship between strategic thought, command, and victory? And that's for all you future commanders out there. The Brits could have continued the campaign, but not. What was their strategic reasoning? Was this a blunder? And lastly, after the war, France did not demand territory or fealty. What does this case teach us about successful state building in post-conflict settings, if anything? I'd like to close on this letter to your right, Washington's address to the Neuburg conspirators. So, you know, the war ended in 1781. The peace treaty was signed in 1783. Tell me if this sounds familiar. A lot of the people who fought in the Continental Army fought for this idea of a better America, and they didn't see it happening. They saw one set of elites replace another set of elites. They saw poverty. The colonies were even more bankrupt than before. In some ways, the new Confederacy of States was more coercive than the British Crown. And there were some officers from some American army officers got together in Neuburg in a meeting, Neuburg is just south of West Point in a farmhouse, and they wanted to have a military coup d'etat in the United States and in place a leader, and they invited Washington up there, I think hoping that he would become the de facto leader, the military dictator. And he reads a very impassioned speech to them, and basically, it says that give Congress a chance. I know you're sucking wind right now, and you have good reason to be, but let's give this experiment a chance. It's a very touching letter, and something that I think all U.S. military officers should read, because in some ways it is the bedrock of America's civ-mil relationship, and it's inconsistent with Washington's entire philosophy of, you know, of becoming the gentleman farmer like Cincinnatus in ancient Rome. If you have any questions, please email me. My name is Dr. Sean McFate. You can read more about strategy in my book, The New Rules of War, or you can check out my website. To Americans and to everybody out there, happy July 4th, and now you know hopefully a little bit more about what it means and why.